Well, I want to move into treatment and what the, and I know that this is, you do public speaking. This is probably a 2-day course or longer on treatment. So by no means is this going to cover everything, but just generally when you're planning those treatment sessions, what does that look like as far as, you know, frequency, how do you begin? Is it immediate parent involvement? So some of that, what are your thoughts on treatment?
If I can impart something to listeners in the few moments that I have to get across what I'd like to see for treatment, it is the principles of motor learning. And I wish that we were taught the principles of motor learning in graduate school. And I don't know anyone who is unless they have a professor who specializes in apraxia. But if we were taught the principles of motor learning, our practice across the board, grammar, expressive language, everything would be so much more effective and phonology and so much better. It really would. And, you know, I think we're getting there, but essentially the crux of principles of motor learning is that speech is a motor skill, at least especially for apraxia. Okay. I'm not saying don't use your phono approaches for phonological disorder. I'm just saying if speech is a motor act, what we do is we have very specific practice schedules. And first we get acquisition and then we need to get carryover. So in our therapy room, acquisition doesn't just end. We all know those kids who perform in our therapy room and leave the door and it's all gone. With motor learning, there is a specific and strategic plan for that carryover to happen. And it all falls into the principles of motor learning that is the workshop. So, you know, basically we need to get, to maximize principles of motor learning, we need to have a high amount of practice reps. When I give my workshops, like there's this one research article that shows in phono approaches when they did a study, SLPs were getting around 30 to 60 reps per session. For apraxia, we're up to 120 wow. at least. So we're doubling the highest end of how many reps we're getting with phonology. And to do that, we're not going to pick, you know, let's say we have, you know, a speech sound, a phonology mind. We try to look at all the words that we can with that particular target. With apraxia, we're going to narrow and focus, and we're going to have a very small practice set of words to maximize the amount of repetitions we get and that are needed for true motor learning to occur of the target.
And is this...
In a nutshell.
Okay. I mean, your work is done.
That makes sense, right?
go out, SLPs, and treat this. So is this kind of how would you think of this as muscle memory, where you're doing it so many repetitions that it just, so it's similar concept.
Yeah, I feel when I took prompt training, the best thing I had that they described it is like, you know, when your dogs are in the backyard and they're chasing the squirrel or they're going out to bark, they follow the same route every single time. That is what we're doing. We are carving the same route over and over and over so that they are able to access it. And what you'll see, what can be very dangerous if a therapist doesn't know what they're doing is if we don't pick, like if we're only doing that with one sound, let's say a therapist does know, okay, I need small amount of words, high practice set, lots of repetition. And then they only pick one sound or one target. That sound gets overgeneralized to the whole speech system. Because we always have to be focused on the movements of the sound and programming and planning the movements in a variety of different syllable shapes alongside different vowels and consonant combinations.
So it has to be controlled or it can quickly get out of control.
Yes, 100%. And that's exactly why phonology approaches don't work. So let's say a therapist sees the final consonant deletion, which a child with apraxia can have phonology. So they're looking at this child, but this just happens. This is why it's very readily off the top of my head. So they see this kid who does have a ton of phonological processes going on. They decide to tackle final consonant deletion, something that's very typical. All of us would decide to tackle first. And what they did is they created a motor plan to put a final consonant on every single word after that. So even though they weren't targeting, you know, let's say a word like apple and putting a final consonant on it, they have effectively done that now for every other word because what they taught was a motor plan for a final consonant only and not contrasted it with other syllable shapes like a, you know, a VC where, or sorry, a CV where we leave it open or a VCV where we leave it open, you know. So we can't get stuck on one pattern. We can't get stuck on one sound. It's got to be on the movement sequences. Movement gestures is another term you'll hear experts use.
And so if you do get stuck, then do you almost have to undo it?
Yep.
Oh, man. That's yep. not fun for anybody.
Nope. And it almost takes, no. And it almost takes longer than it would mm-hmm. had you just done it right to get it in the first time.
So that's why it's so yeah. critical to really have a good understanding of what you're doing, why you're doing it, and what you're trying to accomplish. Because if not, like you said, you're having to undo things. And mm-hmm. then I'm sure that's frustrating for everybody.
Yeah. And so I think that, you know, it is kind of nice to have a podcast where you leave it open because in terms of treatment, because I think my biggest thing and why I wrote, one of the reasons I wrote my book and why I try to get mm-hmm. to college students before they graduate is because SLPs, myself included, come out of grad school, get mm-hmm. your C's, and you presume, I don't anymore. I think, you know, senior veteran SLPs like you and me that have been around for a little bit probably recognize that we didn't actually know every single thing there was to know from birth to geriatrics mm-hmm. with speech, language, voice, swallowing, cognition, you know, like, but for some reason you come out of school, you get your C's, you're like, okay, I am the expert mm-hmm. in the building on speech. I have to know everything related to speech and language. And we just don't.
No.
So I think my message is, please always be a lifelong learner. If you don't know what I'm talking about, or you mm-hmm. only have a peripheral knowledge of principles of motor learning, you have to get extra training if you expect yourself to be an effective SLP for the student or client with apraxia on your caseload.